Again, last week, Mark shared with us a great message about the importance of that commandment about taking a Sabbath. And I tell you, it's an interesting subject because for most of the people I run around with, most of the colleagues that I interact with, most of the ones that I email to say, hey, how are you guys approaching this situation? Or, you know, we have this situation, any advice? Or what about this or what about that? For most of them, me included, this discipline of finding rest, of saying yes to a Sabbath, is much easier said than done. You know, because like many of you, we like our jobs. We like what we're called to do. We love, well, most of the time, what we're called to do. And so like many of you, whether you own your business, whether you're a manager or a director or you're head of something, many of you, for most of the time, love what you do. You enjoy it. And so as we talked about last week, it's easy. Technology makes it really easy to bring that on home. And to bring it on home not just for the evening, but for the weekends and for early mornings and for late nights. And then all of a sudden, you've squeezed out everything but what you do. And so I share this not as a way of saying, oh, look what the pastors do. Rather, I share this as a way to be saying, I'm in the journey with you. And so as we think of the Sabbath, and as we think of rest, you know, finding rest in a restless world, then we think of this week's message of serving. It's like, you know what? I'm just not quite sure rest and serving go together. In fact, it's like, should we have done something else besides serving as a part of this series? And, oh, there are plenty of disciplines. There are plenty of tools in the toolbox that will help us find rest. I thought, why did we do serve? And why did we have to do it right after the week of Sabbath? And so that's what I hope to unpack a little bit for us this morning. Let me pray. Thank you, God, that you are God of the city. Thank you for your presence here. Thank you for the folks that have gotten up and have walked into these doors. And we know, God, that many come with different burdens. Many come with different thoughts in their hearts, everything from joy to sorrow, from worry and concern to peace. And that is what is in this room that's called New Life. And so I thank you. And I pray, God, that the thoughts that are in their hearts, that folks won't check them at the door, but that they'll bring them here. Because in here are people that love them. In here is your spirit. And so I pray that the thoughts that are going on in people's minds and in people's hearts, and that my words today will be acceptable in your sight, because you are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Now, as in any of the tools, so to speak, any of the ways of finding rest in a restless world, we know that in those tools is not salvation, so to speak. In those tools, we don't find our ticket to heaven. In those tools, we don't find the peace of life in the tool themselves. Folks, and that goes to some of the more, what you may consider the more spiritual ones. Now, the Word of God, as we talked about, is foundational, and it points us to Jesus. And taking a Sabbath, doing some solitude and silence, And next week when we talk about prayer, those are all tools. But in and of themselves, it is critical that we know that these tools don't make God love me anymore. These tools that we've talked about over the summer are not a checklist. So when I die, I get to heaven. But rather, they're tools for us to use every day of our lives. So our lives are transformed from the inside out to be the person that God wants us to be. So as we struggle with, journey on, work through what it means to find rest in a restless world, we really do become more like Jesus. And our hearts are transformed. And so today, as I think about serving, it is, again, even more for today's subject, that we know that serving doesn't make the golden path to heaven any smoother. Serving, if you're a servaholic, that doesn't mean you love Jesus any more than somebody else. But as I dived into this and struggled with it, with the subject of Sabbath, how do we serve? How do we have a Sabbath? I'm brought to a passage in the New Testament. Passage by Paul in Ephesians 2, 8 through 10. It's found on page 815 in the Bibles in the chairs in front of you. But it says this: "For it is by grace that you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by work, so that no one may boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." Many who have been around the church have heard this verse often, especially when it comes to serving, that it is not by what we do. It is really by what Christ has done for us. And I think we know that. But in our culture of winning approval, of doing more, we sometimes get some things a little confused. And our lives turn into living out the shoulds. I should, because I want God to love me more, and I want another jewel in my crown, so to speak. So I say that not as an easy off or an easy excuse for people not to serve, but just to remember as we dive into this subject, that it is not by serving that we win God's favor. It is not by serving that we spend eternity with God Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. It is really because of Jesus and what he has done for us. But this verse, this classic verse, is a reminder that we are God's handiwork and that we are created to do good works. It's just a part of our DNA. It's probably how the pendulum swings when we decide and when we want to do something. It's because you just want to, because you know what? There's something wired in us that, you know what? I can do something. I can be a part of that. I can fix that. I can contribute to that. Again, serving, we talk about it, we teach about it, many, many opportunities to take a step around here, but an author, Jan Johnson, defines serving as doing good for others with no thoughts of ourselves. Doing good for others with no thoughts of ourselves. And it's interesting that as we do good for others with no thoughts of ourselves, God is training us to be selfless, to be other-focused. as we do good for others with no thoughts of ourselves, our spirituality is being moved from our heads into our hands, and then to the people who we connect with. And as we do good for others with no thoughts of ourselves, we are at times forced to the edge. Meaning it's not always the most fun thing to do when you serve, depending on where you're serving. But we're forced to the edge and stretched in our prayer life. And in that, our prayers grow. And we grow, and we become a different person. Why? Because we have done some good for others with no thoughts of ourselves. And as we do that again, we gain permission, we gain respect, we gain the blessing of hearing and walking in somebody else's story. For as we serve, we also listen. As we serve, we hear the stories, whether it's of other people around us who are serving with us, or whether it's from those people that we serve. And so there are many blessings from serving. In fact, Richard Foster, you know, one of the gurus of spiritual disciplines, says this: the grace of humility is woven into our lives as we do good for others with no thoughts of ourselves. Again, the grace of humility is woven into our lives because, you know, after you serve, and whether it's local or whether it's away from our church somehow, you start to realize that we do live a pretty privileged life. Despite being tight at times financially, that for most of the community, most of the world, we really are quite well off. And as you interact with others, as you see their pain, you realize the humility that everything I have really does come from God. And so again, it is the process in serving that we do become more like Jesus. It's in the process of serving, when we do good for others with no thoughts of ourselves, that we become the hands and the feet of our Creator. And we express His power here on earth. And for many of you who have served, you've experienced that. Even for the student leaders who went off to camp for a week, serving, even though it's camp, it is, trust me, it is serving, that they're able to see God's power move in ways that they never could have imagined. Dallas Willard, another scholar, says this about serving. In fact, he adds the word secrecy to serving. Because there are some things you just can't be secret about. I mean, if you're handing out food in our food distribution ministry, there's nothing secret about that. You're handing out the food. People see you. Our Tuesday team that helps keep this place in order, you know, the paint doesn't magically appear on the wall or something doesn't magically get hung. They're actually there doing the work. So secrecy can't always happen. But Dallas Willard says this about the secret, about adding the element of secrecy to when we serve. That as we do good for others with no thoughts of ourselves, the discipline of secrecy will help us break the grip of human opinion over our souls and our actions. That's really why at times I don't want to, let's say if somebody had donated, you know, when we raised the money a couple years ago, the $10,000, if somebody would have, nobody did, but if somebody would have said, here's the $10,000, you know, to say, these TVs donated by John Doe or Susie Q. You know, now when I worked at the university, I mean, big bucks were raised when people put a name on the building, millions of dollars. But I can be bought. No, if you want to give a couple hundred thousand, we'd probably redo that activity center and gym in a heartbeat, and I'd call it Betty's Gym or Ray's Kitchen. I don't care what to call it, you know. So I can be bought. But the point is this, folks, is that it is good to give without everybody knowing what you're giving. And what happens from that, from just you giving and people not knowing, is that we do, as Dallas Willard says, we lose that grip of opinion over what we do. Because even though we're successful, and even though we want to live our lives as God has directed us, deep down all of us probably want some approval somewhere. We want to be affirmed. And that's not evil. That's just natural. But by giving in secret, nobody knows. And so we lose that grip of getting the old pat on the back, of seeing our name on every chair. And I know many people donated for these chairs. Again, I'm not saying, let me just clarify that. I'm not saying if you go into a church and you see that somewhere or in another building, that I don't want you to be thinking, oh, those pagans, look how they've raised money. They got plaques all over. Nope. If that's how they choose to do it, that's okay. But just understand that there is a value in secrecy. That you don't need, I don't think we need our name on everything we help. That we help to do. And in being secret about it, it frees us from the grip of people's approval on everything that we say and do. Folks, and as we do good for others with no thoughts of ourselves, we again embody the verse that I opened up with this morning in Ephesians. We embody the reality that we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works. And Jesus is the example of a way to serve. You know, it was on a night that most of us know about, that night when Jesus was hanging around with the disciples, ready to have a meal. In the moment, history was about to change. And yet, a little bit of a smell going on. They hadn't even had dinner yet, so it wasn't from what they ate, but it was their feet. Walking around all day in the dirt, in the hot dirt. Our feet would stink. And just because they're disciples of Jesus, there wasn't some magic potion that didn't make your feet stink because you were with Jesus. Their feet stunk. And in their culture, the tradition was low man on the totem pole cleans the feet of everybody. And so whether it was the youngest slave or the newest one hired, usually was the one stuck going around and cleaning everybody's feet. But Jesus, we read this as John tells us this in John 13, 4 through 5, and then a little bit later in 14 and 15. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. A few verses later, Jesus says, "Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you." He grabbed the towel and he washed his friend's feet. The significance of a towel in the act of serving. Let me also be clear that there are some traditions that have taken these verses and they would put them on the same elevation as we would do with baptism or communion. They would call it a sacrament. And a sacrament is basically, besides a big old word that many of us may not know what it means, is really some tangible way of remembering Jesus. You know, and we go through that when we celebrate communion, when we baptize a baby, we remember God's promise. And so they've taken this verse and they have said, we also will have the feet washing as a sacrament. And, you know, whenever that particular congregation feels necessary, everybody will come in and wash their feet. Somebody, the leaders, the elders, will come in and wash feet. Again, I'm not saying that that's evil, that's wrong, or that's a misinterpretation. Our tradition has two sacraments. So here's a little church, not church history, but here's a little polity about New Life. Our two sacraments are baptism and communion. But it doesn't mean we don't have a lesson to learn from Jesus washing the feet. Because again, in that culture, feet were horribly dirty. They were, you know, some of you go in for a pedicure, and I'll admit, I've had two with some friends. When I go to Michigan, they're like, you're going to get a pedicure with us. It's like, ew. So and I try not to laugh when they're touching my feet. But anyway, it isn't that type of a situation. I mean, these are just filthy, caked on dirt. And so God Almighty shows them, humbles himself, and washes their feet. So then in our culture, how that translates for us is that, okay, what can we do for others? What can we do that's humbling? And at times, it will be humbling. What can we do to pick up a towel and to serve? Not because picking up this towel is going to give me the pass to Jesus, but picking up the towel changes my heart to be more like Jesus. And we know that when people experience love, when people experience us loving on them in times of need, they also then see Jesus. They look at the church in a whole different way. When the church has come, whether it's to install smoke detectors, whether it's to hand out some food, people look at the church a little differently versus just the building on a street corner. So again, as we go through our days and opportunities to serve, you may not be asked to wash somebody's feet, but God may be nudging you to serve in ways that you may think are below you. God may be asking you to put on the towel of humility and to serve someplace. So again, I want to move to also 1 Samuel 12:24, because I think it has a key into what it means to serve, a key element. 1 Samuel 12:24, page 193 says, "Be sure to fear the Lord and serve him faithfully with all your heart. Consider what great things he has done for you." Consider what great things he has done for you. Folks, that means we need an attitude change. Some of us do. Some of you are wonderful. You have a heart, you've heard the term, a heart for service. Others need to have a heart of gratitude. And that helps us to serve with a more pure heart, to serve in a way that God can use us really to be a blessing. And it's almost like I'm just saying, let's just say there was somebody going to be getting married in 2 weeks, you know. If somebody wasn't getting married in 2 weeks and you were to happen to say to that somebody, hey, are you ready for marriage? You're ready for the big day? He may respond with, you know, I've been born ready. I've been waiting for this day for 27 years. That's the attitude we need with serving. You know, I've been born ready. I am ready to go out there and do it. Even though it's going to be hot, even though I got to move some chairs, pick up some trash, weed some gardens, I've been born ready, and I'm going to do it. And I think it's at this point. It's at this point that we have the attitude of, I've been born ready. We have the attitude of humility and of serving. That I think that is where rest and serving come together. It's at that point that we realize that something miraculously happens within us. It's at that point of serving together that we realize that together, yes, we can be, and we are new life for the city. It's in serving with a good heart and a positive attitude. As we see, as these kids, the youth leaders, I mean, tirelessly going from sunup to sundown and then a few hours, that they see God work. And it's at those moments that an inner rest starts to happen. Because it's at those moments that all of a sudden we realize, you know what? I don't need to do everything for everybody. God's called me to serve in this, and I can do that. I can say no to this. I can serve. I can be a part of a greater initiative for God's purpose. And I don't have to always win the approval of my boss, making the next sale, closing the next project, making the next phone call. It's in serving that we really become even more okay with how God has created us. And it's in becoming more okay that all of a sudden service is one of the tools that God can use to bring rest in a restless world. You almost can't explain it. You can't document it. And again, there are some who are still using service as a way, I got to, I should. They're running themselves ragged, and it's okay to say no. Because as we say no at times, that opens up another opportunity for other people to serve. As we say no, we're really allowing God to help fill a void in somebody else's life. Because, folks, we work like crazy. We try to save every nickel. Some of us try to save every nickel we have for certain things and to reach our next goal. We want to do, and we're running crazy trying to live up to everybody else's standards, but rather than living according to how God has made us. So finding rest in a restless world, serving really does fit in to that. Transforms our life and allows us to serve. So how do we bring that home? So what difference does it make? And you know, I'm speaking for our staff. I am speaking for the board when we say we don't want people to burn out. This isn't a Sunday of guilt by any stretch of the imagination. But I really hope that it is a Sunday of freedom. It's a Sunday to lean into how God has created you. As a church, we don't want a few people doing everything. That's not healthy. That's not good. That's not being part of the body. But we do want everybody who can do something. We don't want a few doing everything, but we do want everybody who can do something. And we've been blessed with a huge amount of volunteers here at New Life. With every strength, there's a weakness, right? Our personalities, you know, you're outgoing. When after a while, it's like just tone it down, shut up, take a rest, you know. So there's always the flip side to somebody's strength, you know, and there's always a flip side to us as a body We have strengths and we have weaknesses. You know, and one of our strengths is that we have a more mature crowd. Our church is made up of older people, even older than me. And that's okay. It's good that some of you are over 40. You know, I'm okay with that. But let me just say here again that, and it could be it's because of your age, many of you, that you've caught on to this already. That you realize that you don't have to kiss up to your boss, your spouse, to somebody, but that you know there is value in serving. You've heard about this long before I've been here. You know, the right people at the right place at the right time. To plug in to the body. And the older we get, the more we get it. And the more you get it as New Life Community Church. And so I am honored and thrilled that that's a part of our DNA. It's nothing new that I'm sharing with you today. You know that one person can't serve 130 to 200 people in our food distribution. One can't pull it off. There's over 100 of you that make that happen each week. VBS, while there's 420 or 450 pushing more people here throughout a week, that doesn't happen just by one person. Over 60 volunteers make that happen. Ryan going to camp. It isn't just Ryan saying, rah, rah, let's go, 30 high school and junior high kids. But it's his whole team. And again, as you've heard, it's all of you buying the donuts, supporting the fundraisers, being in prayer, because some of you are never going to camp. Again, those days are gone. You are not about to be a youth sponsor for Ryan. You'd be saying, Junior, you'd be doing a funeral the following week. And I'm okay with that. I mean, not doing your funeral, but I'm okay. I'll work you till you're dead. No, okay. It's okay to know that there are boundaries in what you can and can't do. And those will change as we change. And as God moves in your heart. Even worship, this experience isn't just because I'm here, because of over 25 people participating one way or another makes this hour and 15 minutes happen. A whole lot can happen when we work together as God's people. And so I think we get that as a church, for the most part. I think we get that. And yet the flip side is that at times there are the couch potatoes in a church. You know, those people that just lay around, sit around, and flip the TV channel. So I'll call those the chair chumps, because we have chairs. If I was in a more traditional church, I'd probably call it a pew somebody, because there's a pew. But we have chairs, and so there are chair chumps, if it's not here, in other churches. And we know that God at times will not use a chair chump, because a chair chump doesn't do much. It consumes, and we've talked about consumerism, and that Christianity isn't consumerism. But there are some chair chumps that sit in the chair, and as a couch potato will watch the TV show or the sports event and basically tell everybody what the coach is doing wrong. The chair chump does the same thing. The chair chumps are those who come in or go to every event we have and they sit on the chair. Oh, they may be learning God's word cognitively. They may be understanding it, but they're just a chair chump. Because after church, after the life group, they all go out to lunch and they just talk about what isn't going right, and they talk about what people ought to do, what somebody should do, and yet what are they doing? They're just sitting on the chair. They're just being a chump on a chair. And I think, if we were honest, that happens to probably most of us. Now, when I go on vacation and go to a church, I have to make sure I don't become a chair chump in that church, because I can start to analyze everything in the service. And it's just like, that isn't healthy. It isn't fair to the whole experience. And when my friends say, well, what do you think? And I say, well, let me tell you what I think. You know, I couldn't find the door. There were no bathroom signs. People were mean. I could, you know, it's like, calm down, you know. So I think at times we need to battle being a chair chump. And I know for some that's a little offensive. I didn't use the word lazy because some of us are really offended by that word. And I also know, and I think you understand this, that because you're in a chair and you can't volunteer or serve someplace, it doesn't mean you're a chump. It means for whatever reason, and most of it's health-wise, that it is almost impossible for you to hand out food, to go to Ryan, go to camp with Ryan, for to serve the hundreds of people at our pumpkin bash, for even to be here when we had over 100 people for our camping experience, or VBS. You know, because you're unable to participate with that doesn't make you a chump at all. But I know that you can serve. You can be a prayer team member. You can pray from home. You can pray in your car. You can pray lying down. And we need that. In fact, if you look on the back of your program, you're going to see many, not many, a few key opportunities for you to take a step. Now, for some of you, you need to ignore this. It's okay, because you're already doing probably way too much. And you're not allowing other people to get out of their chair. You're enabling the chair chumps to be chair chumps. And yet for others of you, if you're wondering, okay, you know, is there something I can do? Because again, the benefits of retirement is that you never retire from the kingdom. And so there's always something to do. And so if you're looking for something to do, you can look on the back of the program and you'll see opportunities. Opportunities to take a step. Opportunities to be a part of something larger. Opportunities to say, how can God use me to be new life for the city? Again, folks, you know, we know that God has chosen, most of the people he chose to do something were people already involved. You know, most famous examples would be the disciples. They were already fishing. They were already fishermen, hardworking people that could get the job done. And he made up a whole team of those people. And throughout Scripture, you'll be able to see time and time again, it's the busy people that God has used to make something happen. And so today, if you're not busy, if you're thinking, you know what, as we enter into the fall, what new ministry or what can I be involved with? How can God fill that void in me to make a difference? And so take a look at this. And, you know, one of the benefits of growing is that we now need more help in the nursery to take care of these little kids. And so you can just look through this and see things. And even I mentioned the prayer team. And I don't just throw that out there because it's the word prayer and we're a church and I guess we ought to be praying. But folks, as we continue to move forward, and next week it's all on prayer, prayer is going to be foundational as we continue to move forward to be new life for the city. And so for many of you who can't get out, but your heart is with us, sign up to be a part of that prayer team. And I'm convinced that through the everyday things that we do, that God is going to use us. God has used us and will continue to use us to be a blessing as we serve. Not because we're making a way to heaven, but because God is changing our hearts and God has created us to serve. So rather than fight it, let's lean into it and make a difference as a community. Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, again for the way that you have created us. Thank you for your example of grabbing a towel and humbling yourself to serve. And thank you here for the people of New Life, people who for over 80 years have served you in many, many different capacities. And so I pray that we'll continue, to be a people who that we are finding rest in a restless world, and that we're doing so as we serve you. Because we know, God, that you can just take our everyday lives and do something miraculous with that. And you will receive the glory as that happens. Amen. We're going to continue to respond this morning. And we continue to respond as you're welcome to stay in your chairs. You're welcome to reflect. You're welcome to come forward or in the back where we have a rover coming forward to serve communion as a reminder of what Christ has done for you. You know, the ushers are going to come forward and they're going to receive your offerings. Again, not as a way that your offering gets you to heaven, but out of your heartfelt gratitude, you give back to God. Some of you may want to light a candle here or in the back as a way to represent the light of Christ that needs to enter into a dark place. And maybe that dark place is you've been just too busy doing the wrong things. So light a candle saying, Lord, help me. And maybe you need to nail something to the cross to give it back to Jesus. Maybe you need to talk with somebody. Have a conversation. So we'll have people from our prayer team over here by the organ who would be honored to pray with you to see how they can assist you in connecting with God. And so as we wrap up this morning, let us do so, and as we continue to worship in response.